I'm Darren Winham, the Economic Development Director for the Town of Exeter, New Hampshire. This is our inaugural Economic Development Show, and today we are with Mike Curry, President of a new company in Exeter, C3i. And today we're going to talk about...
We're going to talk about C3i, and thanks, Darren, for coming in this afternoon. It's a delight to host you, and we are absolutely delighted to be here in Exeter. I've got a team of about 20 folks in the company, and they're having so much fun. So we have a great building, we have a great site, and hopefully we can walk around in a bit and I can show you some of what we're playing with here.
Excellent. Well, I had sent you some questions.
Darren, if I could just launch into just Please. A couple of slides to show you what we're doing here, because
Excellent.
I think that will be important to understand why we're here and why we chose Exeter in the first place.
Excellent. Thank you.
Jumping back 18 years almost, the company was founded by Charlie Wagner. And the original technology that we're now building was based on a system to monitor batteries and the battery charges at Knowles Atomic Power Laboratory in New York. That led to a number of contracts over the years. There are small business innovative research contracts. We received numbers of those over the ensuing years. And that led to developing a system that we are now putting onto Navy ships to control any of the assets for recovering or launching air platforms, for instance, helicopters or the JSF Stowe, or potentially in the future, some of the unmanned aerial vehicles. So those are some of the pictures of the early systems that we had developed, and they grew into more and more technologically advanced items. As you can see here, the control panel and some of the other peripheral devices in the top picture. All of that equipment was installed in that experimental ship, which is in the bottom right of this slide. That was the Sea Fighter, and it was what the Navy tested many of their pieces of equipment on to verify, validate that it was functioning as it should. So the Navy, with the help of numbers of NAVAIR Lakehurst technicians, George Bray, Dave Eisen, Kurt Hardick, those folks helped us define, refine, build a little more, and we put the equipment onto that ship. The Navy then tested it extensively, very happy with it. It came out of that test cycle, the Navy made a decision to put it on the ships of the fleet that we have running around today.
Beautiful.
This is probably our bread and butter program right now. This is a picture of the DDG-1000, the USS Zumwalt, which is now in San Diego. And we have more than 125 pieces of equipment on that ship controlling all of those different devices that are listed in the blue boxes. Telerobotic firefighting nozzles to put fires out on the top side of the flight deck and the other parts of the ship. Fuel quality monitors, all of the topside lighting, navigation lighting. We control the safety hatches that open to provide protection to the Navy crew when they're operating on the flight deck. We control some of the devices that are used in recovering the helicopters onto the flight deck, the advanced stabilized glide slope indicator, and we operate almost all of the lighting in the boat bay. So we are controlling those devices using our hardware, our network hardware, and our software.
The picture on the bottom right, is that showing those lights? Is that showing what your equipment's doing?
Yes, that picture would be what the pilot would see recovering at night on the stern of this ship. And our control device, our control panel, actually has a night vision compatible screen. And almost all of the night flights are now operating with goggles. So the operators on the ship must have a night vision compatible viewing screen so that you don't blind the pilots with white light coming out of a display screen.
No, I served on a destroyer. I don't remember it looking like that at all.
No, that's a pretty modern ship, Darren. That ship is probably the most technologically advanced ship in the Navy, if not the world today. There's no doubt about it. It's got more new features of any ship that's operating in the fleet today. It's a big ship too. It's about 14 or 15,000 tons. It's a destroyer. It's a guided missile destroyer. And you can see it's all built for radar stealth protection.
And you have how many pieces on that?
More than 120 individual pieces.
Manufactured right here in New Hampshire.
Manufactured right in our old facility and this current facility.
Excellent.
Yep.
That's great.
And those range from control panels to network devices to individual computer modules that would be in all of the devices that we're controlling. We have, on an LED-based lighting system, you have to have a driver, very similar to the driver that you would have in your printer, for instance, to drive whatever you're printing from your laptop. Okay. You have to have that type of hardware interface in order to drive the lights, the LED lights. And the Navy is moving towards a full LED type ship for the Green Fleet, as well as just the fact that you don't have to replace an LED light for 50 or 70,000 hours. So it's essentially the life of a ship. And that's deriving in significant savings per ship over the life of a ship, as you can imagine.
Of course.
You don't have to carry thousands of fluorescent light bulbs like you may remember in our old days in the Navy.
That's great.
So we continue developing hardware, and we have also delivered hardware to the Air Force. We have a number of pieces of hardware down at Eglin Air Force Base, and
we're controlling in Florida.
We're controlling a landing strip where the Air Force is operating the V-22 Osprey aircraft. We have other systems that are being used to control the lighting on a large deck amphibious ship for the JSF Stow, the Joint Strike Fighter STO aircraft.
Right.
So our system is controlling many of those ships' equipment.
Is Dan Bischoff an employee here?
Unfortunately, he is not. We wish he was, but he's a government employee, and he's installing the lighting that we control on a large deck amphibious ship.
Gotcha.
We are also ISO 9001:2015. I always like to plug that in there. And we just qualified not too long ago, this past March. We also have received from the government what's called an authorization for alternate release. And what that allows us to do is build our equipment for the US government, and we do not require to have a government inspector come on site and inspect it. They're comfortable with our quality procedures, and they have authorized us to be able to ship our equipment directly to the government without that step, without the government inspecting. I've worked in the business for a few years, as you can see, and I don't know of very many companies that have been able to manage that. And this is our third year in a row, so we're really...
So it's an annual, so
you have to do it every year.
Beautiful.
So we're really pleased by that. Our manufacturing team does a great job. This is our company, pretty standard organization chart. We have some software development, which is becoming more of a feature of our business. And I have an offsite lab up in Bath, Maine, because that's where they were building the ship that you saw on the previous slide.
Yep.
And then our facility here, which we'll walk around and show you upstairs. We have a full lab of hardware that we are continuously testing, integrating our software to make sure that as the Navy brings on a new device, for instance, we need to be able to integrate that into our software and make sure that it functions as it should.
I don't want to get ahead, because I'm not sure if this question is in the slide, but are you able to get your employees, get the training you need, people with the training that you need right through UNH or from local programs, or are you finding you have to go further away to get folks and woo them up here?
Our pedigree here in the company, a lot of the employees have come from Henschel, which used to be down in Newburyport. Henschel moved down to Ayers when they were purchased by L3 Communications, and a lot of employees didn't want to commute that far.
Right.
So we were fortunate, and that was probably 8 years ago, seven, 8 years ago, we were fortunate to pick up a number of high quality technical folks company-wide. That was in the software and the electrical engineering, hardware, mechanical engineering. So we were really fortunate. Henschel, unfortunately, maybe wasn't as fortunate. But we have also found other talent at UNH. We're building a bridge right now with Ellen Christo there, or Elaine Christo, Ellen Christo, I'm not sure. But she is part of the business development group at UNH trying to build bridges to industry.
Oh, great.
So we've reached to her and she's working with us. We're going to try to move down a path to build some relationships for cyber. We think that could be the next major piece of business for the government in the software world.
Maybe a chance for apprenticeships?
That is exactly what we would be talking about. Would both be apprentice or intern programs.
Wonderful.
Either while they're at school or when they graduate from school. And we're looking to establish exactly that footprint with Ellen. So
that's great.
Looking forward to keeping that moving down the path. We also have reach to our local high schools, and we have I'd say we have 7 graduates of Winnicott High School.
Yep.
And so we've reached through to them. That's right around where we used to be located in Hampton.
Yep.
So that was the closest school, and a lot of those guys were just coming to us right out of high school. And
Wexford High is right down the road.
And we'll be moving our search to that pretty shortly, as you know. So anyway, we've got a full up lab in 2 spots, and we do quite a bit of software development in both of the sites. So these were some of your questions that I received, and I thought I'd just throw some responses on the slides, and we can talk to it if that makes sense.
Sure, please.
First question is, why did we decide to come to Exeter? Interesting. Our building had been sold out, and the owner that came in to take over the building was very interested in consolidating some of the footprint, and we were scattered in various spots of the previous building. And I talked to the owner and I said, you know, I think it might be time for us to take a look at moving into our own building. So of course, the first thing we did was look at existing buildings because of the economics of it. So we looked everywhere within a 20-mile radius, and we didn't find a single facility that fit our needs,
right,
with one exception, which was up in Dover. It was a beautiful building. It was right across from Liberty Mutual.
Yep.
And it was perfect. Mm-hmm. It was perfect. The problem is, I put it to my workforce, and 12 of my workers live on the New Hampshire-Massachusetts border, and they said, it's just too far to commute. It's too hard. We can't go that far. It's an hour commute each way. And you know, if you don't have a team of workers, you don't have a company. And so I went to the owner, I said, I just don't think this is the right solution. Let's find something closer. So then, through the grace of good fortune, Darren, someone gave me your name to call, and I placed
that someone was Doug Eastman.
Doug Eastman.
Yeah.
I placed a call to you, and it was opening up the gold mine. And I appreciate all you've done, because you were able to connect us with numbers of different areas, and you and I rode around. We looked at spots all over Exeter, and we saw this. The second we saw this, I said, this is the one.
Yeah.
This is it.
And it sells itself, doesn't it?
Oh, it does.
Yeah.
And we walked all over at the time, the bike trail, the bike paths were all here, and you and I walked all through there, and I said, this is it. And then you were very familiar with the owner of the land, and you connected the dots. And then we signed the paper and off and running we went. So it was beautiful.
Perfect. Yeah, and can you talk a little bit about the path to get through? Because it was obviously very challenging. The bike path, you know, you were very generous with that. The company, you, the owner, everybody, extremely generous with, and you still are, letting people park in your parking lot after hours, use the trails,
right,
help with the connection to the trails.
Right.
And but also, it was very challenging, as we're finding Epping Road is. Just we don't know what's under the ground. We know it's wet. It's just a big, big challenge. And you know, we have, like every town, we have regulations that we have to be very careful when we get into wetland buffers. Mm-hmm. And you know, we were fortunate that Mr. Schaffmaster, if you want to tell that story, that'd be cool. But what he did when he met you, and how he was so, I would say, really good with the price. You know, because we knew that it couldn't be too high a price, or you couldn't simply do it because of the site work costs.
Correct.
And if you don't mind talking about that, I think the listeners from Exeter would appreciate, just sort of from a company standpoint, just how challenging some of those factors are, and frankly how I would say good our boards were to work with to get through all that.
Absolutely, the selling price of the land was very fairly priced in my opinion, and we were able to make that price. We were able to invest in the land, and we purchased the land early up. We purchased the land almost in parallel to applying for the mortgage for the building and the construction costs. I had worked with John Ritchie Construction.
Yeah.
John is a pro, and John was fantastically helpful in guiding me through this process, since I had never built an office building in my career. It was fun to launch, and it was great to have John Ritchie as my mentor through this process. And so he was really strong in, there's going to be a lot of site costs in this building, in the land, because we had to raise the height of the building considerably. Where we're sitting right now, the ground was probably 20 feet below us. And so we had to raise quite a bit. part of it was because we have a stream that runs through,
right,
and we had to build a culvert over that. We then had to build at least 6 or 8 feet above that for running the piping and, you know, the storage lines, the water lines, so that we were able to have the grade of the building without steps coming up into the building, because we were not, as the American Disabilities Act prevents that. So we had to have the parking lot on the same grade as the floor of the building. And so that was a challenge. We had to figure where the building could be located. We worked with MSC, TF Moran,
yep,
and they were magnificent. John Lorden, Jack McKeague, great guys. Absolutely, I recommend them to anybody. Doubly, they knew the process with Exeter. They'd
yep.
been through the planning board process. They'd been through the ConCon process.
Yep.
They knew all the players, and they knew the regulations. So again, I saw Dave Sharples pull out a book of regulations, must have been this thick, and I said, I don't have enough time in my life to read every one of those and know what I'm getting myself into. John Lorden, I'd have to trust you. And he did not let us down at all. And he guided us through it. He worked with Richie's team. I had a great architect, Brandon Holden. Winter Holden is his company in Kittery. All local guys, fantastically helpful. They all knew the process and they guided us through it.
Excellent.
So I would say, you know, one of the questions is what factors really influence us coming here? It was the workforce really. I brought the entire workforce out here for a school trip and we walked the whole thing.
Yeah.
And I said, what do you guys think? And every one of them said, let's go.
Beautiful.
Let's go. This is where we want to be. And we oriented the building. And we put more windows in the building than we probably should have, but I don't know if you could ever put enough windows. And when we walk around, you'll be able to see some of the view out
right.
to the Beaver Pond. Doug Eastman told me that someone had dated the Beaver Pond 600 or 800 years old. I said, I want to have a building right next to that.
Yeah.
I love that.
Nice.
And so all of that was history, and it was just magnificent. So, and as I said, we analyzed everything.
Mm-hmm.
We looked at probably 12 or 15 buildings. We looked at least a dozen, maybe more sites. And this was the one that fit our requirements and our needs the best. And we just signed up and went for it right then. And I love dealing with John Schaffmaster, the former owner. Great guy,
yep.
professional, very helpful. Worked the financials with us, and it was very supportive. So
yeah, he's got a lot of experience, and he has a lot of other properties, you know, and the public knows we're doing other projects with him, and he's a lot of fun to work with.
He is a lot of fun.
He got me lost in the woods the first time I met him. But
he walked me around here a couple times too, and he was a great guy. So again, just to hit the other key points, it's a business friendly climate. What we've seen so far. Our two neighbors are tremendous. These guys over here in Northeast Lantern, we've had a cookout. They come over. They've invited us over. They helped me find the right guy for plowing in the wintertime.
Perfect.
It's just all, it's a family here.
Just say no when they want to take you whitewater rafting. Just say.
No, I'll sign up for that.
Okay, cool. Yeah.
So some of the other things that you had asked, what should other businesses know if they're considering a move here? Describe the process. Did anything unexpected? I would say when you are building an area that has really never been surveyed correctly, challenges all over. We had ledge in at least four corners of the building,
right.
All four corners. And that was unplanned because we had done a half a dozen test pit sites and there was no ledge in any of them.
But there was there not enough of the contingency for that, or?
Oh yeah, I had planned for that.
Because that's what I'm trying to tell some of these other people that are looking to go in, is
right.
You've got to have a contingency, because you won't know, even with the test pits, you won't necessarily know what you're going to get.
We thought we picked great locations for the test pits. We did, because we didn't find any ledge in all five of them. But we missed the ledge in all four corners. So
right.
That was a challenge, and that added some extra.
Can you say how much? I don't know. I'm not on that side of it.
You know, Darren, I'm not sure I can remember how much.
We have a project we're looking at right now, and we're putting a contingency in there for just ledge,
okay.
$200K. And I didn't know. I was trying. I don't know. Is that high? Is that low? I don't know.
I'm not sure.
Know off the top of your head, no big deal.
It depends on the size of your facility footprint. This
is
an 80 by 100 square foot building. We have two floors. And we learned a lot of rules there too. We were asked if we had an elevator in the building. Well, we've structured the building so that I don't need an elevator by the requirements or the rules, because I only have 3,500 feet on my second floor. But I will be adding a second extension, and when that happens, we'll be putting an elevator into the building.
That's great.
No question about that. The other beauty of that is through, again, working with the engineering team, the architect, as well as the planning board, we were allowed to permit having the second floor built, as well as an extension out this side of the building of another 40 feet out. So the building is a steel frame structure, very easy to add additions to. We built it on purpose that way. We don't have a stone facade. We built it with just the metal or the steel siding, and it's a very economical building to expand. It's also an airtight building.
Right.
And so the heating costs are very reasonable, and I would recommend this type frame structure to anybody.
It's built like a ship, right?
It's built like a ship, you got it.
Absolutely. So that begs a couple quick questions. Just so you are thinking about an expansion already, which is fantastic.
Right.
Timeline and workforce increase, if that's information
sure.
you can provide? Or
the Navy has, 99.75% of my business is Navy.
Yep.
So we expect to continue that. The Navy has come to me in the last couple of weeks and indicated that they're going to essentially double to triple my production flow within 2.5 years. And there are a number of ships that are coming into our shipbuilding budget right now that will require my system. For instance, one ship is going to need about 60 pieces of equipment, and they're big pieces of equipment. And so that is going to become, it's a container ship that the Navy has purchased. They're going to turn it into a flight deck, essentially.
Hmm.
No more containers, just a flight deck. And so it's a revolutionary design. They purchased
retrofitting?
It's a retro of a Maersk container ship.
Wow.
And they're just going to remove the containers, obviously, and then just run a flight deck across where the containers used to be. And then they'll be using this for supply support of the amphibious
sure.
landings and all that kind of stuff. So I don't know all the
that's emissions. Pretty timely, frankly.
Oh,
what's going on in the world?
It's perfect. And you know, it's only two years into the future that they're going to hit that target of production. So by that point, I'm going to need more square footage in the building, and I'm going to need more staff. I'm working the numbers right now about how many more people I need to add.
A lot of times when companies, especially companies with a lot of intellectual product like you folks have, what happens is they when they start to grow, they realize, geez, you know, it's cheaper for us if we don't manufacture everything.
Mm-hmm.
Is that something you would ever foresee in the future, or is it they're just so specific, this equipment, that it would never make sense to have somebody try to cut costs, have some other facility that could just manufacture for you?
We're looking at a number of products right now, Darren, that are really cutting edge, and they all have to do with drivers of LED lights or other types of lights. Those could be produced, mass-produced at a another factory far more inexpensively, economically, than I could do it. But for building the control devices and the network devices that we build, I think I have enough capacity and enough throughput capability here that we can manage whatever comes in the future.
Plus, you have to be very always concerned about the quality control, because you have that. That
right.
certification allows you to not have to have inspectors on site.
Exactly, so. Correct. And I've got a trained workforce now that knows the business, knows their business, and we'll over time we can train up a few more, and we'll be in good shape to do that production here. We're not ready to outsource that yet. We
right.
want to keep that. And it's a very niche market we've got. We're the only provider of this at the moment. No other company is providing this hardware and software to the Navy. So as long as we can maintain that niche market, we'll probably do the majority of the production here.
That's great news for us,
yeah.
obviously.
Yep. Good news for me, too. you had mentioned about the wetlands. Yes,
yep.
The wetlands were a challenge. There are a lot of wetlands in this area. If you look out the back of our building, you can see quite a few wetlands in this beaver pond I was mentioning. So we had to come through a lot of that. And all of our permitting process rolled all the way up to the Army Corps of Engineers.
Sure did.
The New Hampshire DES.
Right.
And you were very helpful with that, because we needed an accelerated process. And
oh,
I think
right.
with the assistance you gave, and even sitting and crafting letters, you and I crafted
right.
a couple letters, and we got those into the system. it made a tremendous difference in the speed of the licensing process, because we had a timeline to be out of our old building.
Yeah.
And we met it.
Yep.
We met it. From starting this project, it was probably 4, maybe 5 months of licensing and the mortgaging and all that.
Right.
And then it was 6 months to build. We cut the ground last December and we moved in June of this year.
So we're doing something right now very similar. We're trying to accelerate the process because the company we're working with is like, basically, we need to go.
Go now.
Yeah, so thank you for the familiarity with it, because now I have a little experience with it. So
well, it worked really well for us, and we were delighted. We were delighted. And I threw another plug your way, because the Executive Business Development Manager, I think that's your official title.
Close.
Close enough, okay, whatever. But you were instrumental. You not only just in identifying the land, but then working the whole process from start to finish, and
This is how, if you're really lucky in my line of work, this is like the perfect storm. That happens. Everybody wants to move fast. Company has enough capital to make it happen. Skilled workforce, affable people all around. Some projects don't quite go that smoothly, obviously. But
right.
This one sure did.
So you asked if there are any hidden gems. And you know, I'd say the hidden gems are really, and we've just really arrived here.
Mm-hmm.
A number of my employees obviously have been coming to some of the restaurants and the bars and things, and they know the area pretty well. But we're just starting to really get up to stride here. We were really focused for the first 4 or 5 months on getting furniture into the rooms and making sure it was set up right and getting our production zone set up right. So now we're starting to move into the next phase, I would call it. So we're gonna look to see what we can do next. And next is finding what happens in this lovely town of Exeter. First of all, we're delighted with our neighbors. We've got great neighbors. Cobham, they were very helpful in the early days. I toured their facility a couple times. They pointed out all the things that I shouldn't do that they had done, and the things that I should do that they did really well. They were great. Northeast Lighting, Northeast Distribution, great guys, all good guys. The gem I'd say is that we're within about a 50-yard throw of the rinks, and I've got half of the workforce that plays ice hockey.
Beautiful.
And they couldn't be happier. So they go there at the 5:30 ice rink, or you know, whatever, in the morning, 6, and they're here at 7 and having a great day. So that's really good. The rest of the workforce is on mountain bikes, and
beautiful.
They're using the trails that we are adjacent to, and it's just a perfect fit. And then the restaurants. We have been absolutely delighted. We use the Green Bean all the time for catered lunches.
Great.
We use the Front Row for pizza and sandwiches, and they are so accommodating. Just today I had a group of folks upstairs in a conference, and we called up at 11 o'clock and said, oh my goodness, we forgot to order lunch, and bang, right on time. Sandwiches right at our doorstep. Beautiful. The Hampton Inn has been great, and the Exeter Inn has been magnificent. They've given us a very attractive corporate rate, and we're putting all of our visitors and guests in there whenever we can. And some of our government folks need to be at one of the chain hotels like the Hampton,
right.
And that works out really well. And we've got a nice rate and attraction with those guys down there.
Thank you for saying all that, because these businesses, I'm sure, very much appreciate that. You guys staying local, and it's a big help to the whole economy. So.
And it's a team play here.
Yeah.
And I really get that. And I don't remember the lady's name, unfortunately, but she came from Exeter, or from Hampton Inn, a number of times, just to make sure that we were settling in okay.
Beautiful.
That was just wonderful. We didn't really see very much of that in Hampton. Not to throw a dart at those guys, but Exeter is...
You really, said it, I didn't.
Yeah, there you go. Right. So how is the town to deal with during the entire process? And
you may have hit that already.
I kind of did. You guys were excellent. And that really stretched across all of the planning boards and the other review boards, but also the fire department.
Yeah.
We went to a couple of their meetings because we had to approve numbers of things, and they were great. His name, and
Palmer,
you,
I think, yeah.
Dave Sharples. I didn't work actually that much with Doug. I know John Ritchie worked with Doug all the time, but
this whole thing wouldn't happen without Doug. I always have a morning meeting with Doug because he's like a good friend of mine, and he says he literally, he's like, you got to call this guy. He goes, we need to get these guys. You need to call this guy. And that's exactly what the whole thing happened because if Doug hadn't, I would have anyway, but he was like, you know, Doug's my barometer. And he's great that way because I call him the Fonz. Everybody knows who he is and everybody likes him. Right. You can't walk down the street without Doug, you know. But he really, right from the, when you guys had a conversation by the phone, I think that's how it started.
The question is, did we enjoy working with the town? Absolutely. And I had not been through the process. I had never been to a planning board meeting in my life. Sat in a number of those, and just before me, another client was presenting their case, trying to do something with some construction project somewhere in Exeter. And the planning board was asking incredibly difficult questions. You know, why and how and what, you know, what? And the guy wasn't able to manage it. He didn't survive, and they voted it down. So I'm thinking, oh my god.
Do you know
goodness.
Why? Because it's the professionals that you hire and the people you listed earlier. If I found in this town, even more than other towns, they really respect and appreciate when people do their homework ahead of time.
Right.
If they have a good tech review and all the questions, you know, really I've found that some of these guys, some of the really good professionals, they have the questions right in their pocket before they're asked.
Right.
And they know the answers. And really the ones that say to clients like yourself, you're gonna have to spend a little money because we need to get this done right. It's the cutting the corners, I think, that ends up really hurting these folks with these boards. Because I would argue that our process at this point, because Dave Sharples and some of the other folks, you know, Barb McAvoy and people like that, have sort of streamlined everything to make it as easy as possible if someone follows the rules. If you follow the rules, you're gonna get right on through it.
And
that's my opinion.
Darren, we're an engineering firm. So I understand the benefit and the value of doing your engineering process step by step by step by step, because we can't cut corners on building a piece of hardware. We cannot cut corners on delivering software that functions every time. I saw that process in a different way, but I saw that process with the entire planning board, through ConCon, through the fire department, through everybody. I saw that process. And it's an engineering process that's slightly different. And TF Moran folks, those guys were amazing. And I was just sweating it because the
first one went down
and then my guy got up and he just gave a brilliant presentation.
Yeah.
He had nice colored slides. He told me color makes a difference.
Really?
And it did. It made a big difference because then you could show everything so clearly and concisely. And it was awesome. It was awesome. So. I was a fan from that point forward. So yeah.
Well, I'm glad this is the first interview I'm doing with this show because what we can do is we can show people this, and so when they, you know, when they're thinking about hiring who they hire and going in front of boards,
right,
they can look at this and say, well, maybe I should take the smart path and spend a little more money and get what you pay for in terms of these professionals. So
you need a triumvirate. You need a really good engineering firm. You need to have a really good architect,
yep,
and then you have to have a good construction company, a good general contractor.
Right.
And
Mr. Rich,
we had three that were just superb and did everything that we needed. And everyone had told me, "Oh, be cautious. You know, everybody's going to try to take advantage, and they're going." And I never smelled that once,
right,
with any of the three of those companies. They were all professional, and they were really superb.
That's
superb.
Great.
So favorite part? Well, it's clearly location, location, location. The country setting is really impressive here. We love that.
Yeah.
I mentioned earlier the employee mental shift of going from as a lease tenant to owning your own building or being in your own building makes a huge difference in employee satisfaction, employee engagement. I got guys now that just want to do things, and they even actually go out into the yard and do some yard work. I love that. And I think next spring when we get in here for the first time in a spring setting, we'll put bushes and tell Dave Sharples I have to put a few more bushes to satisfy the, but we'll get there. And we'll take a walk upstairs and show you the view from the second floor. I'm thinking of renting it out for weddings services, so it works perfectly.
Yeah. I want people to see that because I'm trying to get some property sold on the other side of that
right.
same thing.
Right, right.
Which, by the way, just as good a view from the other side. Just
there
saying.
You go. Well, we'll be able to see them and them us, so
yeah,
that'll be good.
Exactly.
And then you mentioned future plans. Yes, we clearly knew that if our business was going to be, if we're going to remain, mm-hmm, we are going to grow.
Right.
And so we have a pretty comfortable growth path And yes, we are going to need to expand or add the second floor that we've engineered ready to go. And again, a final plug is Ritchie Construction. John Ritchie was just superb to deal with.
Excellent.